Praise the Lord. Somebody there has said, praise the Lord. More of him. In your life, more of him. Of his gifts, more of him. Of the water of life, more of him. Of the bread that comes from heaven and makes you strong and keeps you alive, more of him in Jesus' name. Every need of your life, the Lord will supply. And everything he purchased on the cross of Calvary, everything the Father has sent him to give unto you, of the grace, of the gift, of the godliness of glory, he will point your life in Jesus' name. More and more and more of heaven's provision in every life in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We bless your name and glorify you. We're asking at this time, Lord, that you will pour heaven down upon every soul, upon every spirit, upon every child of God in Jesus' name. Do great things in our lives. More of your gifts, more of your grace, more of your power, more of your love, more of the fulfillment of your promises in every life in Jesus' name. Confirm it, O Lord, in every life. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God shout, amen. Tonight, as we come before the Lord, there is one word that is very central in our subject tonight. Is the word strength. Strength, energy, power, divine enablement from heaven, and everything you ought to be, everything you ought to do, everything you ought to achieve, the strength and the power to achieve, the Lord will grant unto you. You will not be tired. Somebody there, I said, you will not be tired. You will not be weary, but the power of heaven and the glory coming from the cross will saturate your life in Jesus' name. Tonight, we're looking at the message, feeding for strength on the heavenly bread. We're feeding, but why? What's the purpose? What's the goal? What's the achievement? Why do we feed? Why do we read the Bible? Why do we hear the word of God? Why do we receive the revelation he gives unto us? Feeding for strength. The journey is long, and every day brings a new challenge. And we need the strength of heaven. We need the power from heaven. We need the enablement from heaven. Feeding for strength on the heavenly bread, and what he gives us, that you feed in the normal way, regularly and every day, so you can be strong, and so you can be all you ought to be, and climb every mountain, and walk every path, and do everything that you ought to do. The same thing spiritually, that we feed so we can have strength, and we're feeding on the heavenly bread, and the Lord feed you until you are totally saturated and you are made strong completely in your life in Jesus' name. Now, for the children of Israel, they were going on a journey. They were going from gloom to glory. They were going from Egypt, and they were going to the land of promise. They were going from the world, and they were going to the world to come. And on a journey like that, that will take many days and many weeks and many months and many years, they needed the strength of the Lord. The same thing with you, my brother, my sister. The journey that we're following now, we need to be strong every day. I will be strong. I said, I will be strong. That's why we feed on the heavenly bread. Look at Exodus chapter 16, we're reading from verse 4. Exodus chapter 16, reading from verse 4. Then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you. That's a mouthful. The Lord God Almighty, he said, there is bread in heaven. You may not have bread in the wilderness, there is bread in heaven. You may not carry enough with you, but there's bread in heaven. And he didn't say, I will send you a little portion. I will rain bread from heaven for you. And the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, and when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness, there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoar frost on the ground. And then in verse 15, it says, and when the children of Israel saw it, they said one to another, it is manna. Somebody said, it is manna. Somebody tell me, it is manna. Somebody tell his brother, his sister, not thereabout, it is manna. But they wist not what it was. They were surprised. Is this the bread from heaven that the Almighty God said, I will rain down? And then in their excitement, they said, it is manna. And Moses said unto them, this is the bread. This is the bread. You live, you eat it, you will live. You eat it, you'll be strong. You eat it, you know, what you eat actually sometimes acts like medicine. What you eat will drive away every sickness and weakness from your system, from your body, in Jesus' name. This is the bread which the Lord has given you to eat. Praise the Lord. The Lord will not forget you on your journey. While you're moving on from here to glory land, it will not forget you in Jesus' name. Every need of every day, it will supply. Every need of your life, of your family, of your profession, of your ministry, it will provide in Jesus' name. You will eat and live. You will eat and be strong. You will eat, you'll be envisioned, and the vision from heaven will so give you a focus. And then as you see the peak where you are going, the strength had been supplied, you will run, you will walk, you will be active in the service of the Lord in Jesus' name. There are three things we're looking at in the message tonight. Number one, divine provision of angels' food for hungry souls. Divine provision of angels' food for hungry souls. Number two, divine purpose for angels' food before honest saints. The purpose, you know, if you're eating for a purpose. If you're drinking any liquid, juice, you're drinking for a purpose. If you're taking in the revelation of the Lord and the bread from heaven, it should be for a purpose. That's what angels eat, and they serve the Lord without getting tired. And the Lord has decided that angels' food will be given to the pilgrims in their pilgrimage, so that they will go to the land of promise. They will not be weary, they will not be tired, they will not faint in the way, in Jesus' name. And if there is any battle against the Amalekites, if there is any battle against the king of Og of Bashan that they have to fight, If there is any battle against the Midianites that they are to fight in the way, against Balak, against Balaam, it is the strength of the food they have that will make them fight victoriously, and they will conquer every enemy like you will conquer every enemy on your way in Jesus' name. Number three now is the divine power through angels' food in harvesting soul seekers. That's me. I said that's me, seeking for souls to harvest them into the kingdom. The power we need, the anointing we need, the authority we need, and the divine ability that we need so that we'll be able to harvest souls into the kingdom. Divine power through angels' food in harvesting soul seekers. Let's come to number one. Number one is the divine provision of angels' food for hungry souls. Three things we're looking at here. Number one, adequate supply for hungry souls. Adequate supply for hungry souls. And when we say we're hungry for quite a lot of things spiritually. We don't want our lives to be just, you know, an average life, ordinary life, just pushing on, just dragging on, and just managing to live. And I don't know whether I'll have the strength for tomorrow or not. No, we want to be upright. We want to be firm. And we want to be strong. And that's why we're hungry for His power. We're hungry for His strength, and we're hungry for divine ability in our lives. And He makes adequate supply, gives adequate supply to those who are hungry souls. Number two, assured satisfaction for hungry seekers. It will satisfy you. It will fill your cup. The amen of the people, tired amen. It will satisfy you as a hungry seeker in Jesus' name. You know the problem is for some people, they seek nothing. There are some people, they say, Lord, that you gave me salvation, that's enough. And they say, I will not ask for anything. I will not ask for my need to be supplied. I will not ask for any gift. I will not ask for more grace. I will not ask for anything. Who am I? Who am I? What am I asking for again? You've given me salvation, and then I'm dragging on. I'm not going to ask for anything. The problem with them is they are not seeking anything. But when you are a hungry seeker and you say, Lord, this is what I want, but that my life will not be ordinary. My life will be extraordinary. You will seek the gift of God. You will seek the enablement from heaven, and the Lord will put it in your life. Number three, abiding sustenance for hungry supplicants. They are hungry, and they're making supplication to the Lord, and they're demanding from the Lord. They're praying. Your prayer will be answered. The prayer you have been praying before the workers' retreat is touch everything like your tears in a bottle. It will pour abundance of the gift and the grace and the enablement into your life in Jesus' name. And the prayers you have been praying from Wednesday, Thursday, and today, and the one you will pray that will round up the workers' retreat tomorrow, you'll be surprised. The Lord will satisfy you. He will give you sustenance. And then you will walk, you will not be weary. And you will run, and you will not faint in Jesus' name. Number one now is the adequate supply for hungry souls. Adequate supply for hungry souls. In Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 15, it says, and gave us them bread from heaven for their hunger, and broughtest forth water from for them out of the rock for their thirst. And he promised them that they should go in to possess the land. That's the reason why the water, the bread, to give you strength and for you to move on and move forward until you get to the land. You will get to that land which thou hast sworn to give them. You're not using the strength to go back to Egypt. You're not using your strength that God gives you with the bread from heaven and the water from heaven. You're not using that strength to do non-essentials and things that will not contribute to your progress in getting to heaven. It is to help you and to lead you to the land which he has given unto you. In Psalm 34 verse 10. Psalm 34, we're reading from verse 10. It says, the young lions do lack, and they suffer hunger. But they that seek the Lord, are they in the house tonight? They that seek the Lord, I said, are they here tonight? You are there, shall not lack, shall not want any good thing. Any good thing. Don't ever tell the Lord, oh Lord, I'm saved, that's enough. I have my name written in the book of life in heaven, that's all. I'm not seeking for gift. I'm not seeking for good things. You can keep that for other people, for me. All I need, I have got. You don't understand the inexhaustible riches that God has provided for you. When you say that, it says, they that seek the Lord shall not lack, shall not want, shall not be deprived of any good thing. Every good thing you will have in Jesus' name. Hey, look at John chapter 6 verse 33. John chapter 6 verse 33. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. He gives life, he gives abundant life, and he gives successful life, he gives progressive life, he gives eternal life. And as you come to him and you say, I've got life, salvation, I've got eternal life, salvation, but you said, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it, tell me, abundantly. That's why he's going to open the heavens for you. Even tonight, he will shower his abundant life upon your life in Jesus' name. Number two now. Number two is assured satisfaction for hungry seekers. Assured satisfaction for hungry seekers. You must seek something from God. You cannot just come here for workers' retreat. Oh Lord, I'm here. I'm trying to fulfill all righteousness. And as you've called us for workers' retreat, I mark the register and I say, yes, I'm present. You must be seeking something. You must want something. And that thing you want, ask, it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock, it shall be opened unto you. Now he's talking about you. Everyone that asketh receiveth, and everyone that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be done, it shall be opened unto them. Open door of heaven for you. Showers of blessing from heaven unto you. And every good thing spiritually, every good thing physically, every good thing for your family, every good thing for the journey ahead of you that you are seeking, the Lord is going to abundantly satisfy you in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 5, we're looking at verse 6. Matthew chapter 5, verse 6, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. You know, people who have been in the church for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years and more, they regularly come to a service, and if you ask some of them, what do you want to get from the Lord today? What are you seeking today? Oh, they say, you know, I've left that to the young believers. I've been here now for all these many years. What am I asking for? Again, no new vision and no new mountain to cross, to climb, and no new activity and service to provide for the Lord, and no new assignment for you to engage in. And then the assignment is greater than who you are, and because of that you're seeking something. How can you say, I've exhausted all the provisions of heaven, I'm not asking for anything anymore? You must. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. After righteousness, the righteousness of, you know, your yesteryears might even be greater than the righteousness of today. At that time, you stood up. At that time, you hurried up. Whatever the Lord said, you want to do promptly and immediately. But you know, the righteousness of today, it has become just a habit. I did it yesterday, and I don't even have to pray now. I don't have to think now. I don't have to ask God for any divine strength. I just keep on, I've done it so long a time, I know how to do it. But it's asking for fresh righteousness. It's asking for a kind of righteousness that the Lord will say, that's great, that's new. That's a new way of following after the Lord. That's why you're thirsty, and that's why you're hungry. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. I will be filled. I said, I will be filled. You know, sometimes you want to bath, and the water there, you don't have enough water, not enough water. And when you take your bath with not enough water, it's like you have not bathed. Sometimes you are very hungry, and then you go to eat, and the food there will not silence the hunger. You eat, but there's no satisfaction. The same thing, you come to church, you come to conference, you come to workers' retreat, and everything you are having can barely satisfy the hunger of your heart. But the Lord wants you to be satisfied abundantly. He will satisfy you. In Luke chapter 11, we're reading from verse 9. In Luke chapter 11, verse 9, but and I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given you. Give me a good amen. What if I hear a message for 1 hour, and all that has been said, and all the scriptures that were read for that 1 hour, I'm now to ask, I'm now to pray, and I just stand there, and I just had a message for 1 hour, and I cannot remember any word I heard. And if I'm going to pray, I just open my mouth, and then I repeated what I used to repeat in prayer for all these many years. That doesn't look like I'm growing if I'm doing that. But he says, after you have the word of God and you see the gifts coming from heaven, the grace coming from heaven, the bread of life coming from heaven, and the water of life coming from heaven, and the provision coming from heaven, and the divine ability and strength you could have, and the way you could be upright and righteous and run and not be weary with the Lord, then you come to prayer, you say, that's what I'm going to have. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. And it says, knock, and it shall be opened unto you. The door is open to you today. All the things you need from heaven, they are granted in Jesus' name. And look at verse 13 there. In verse 13, it says, if ye then, natural people, being evil naturally, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father, your Father, your heavenly Father. You are a child in the family, a son, a daughter in the family. How much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Ghost to them that ask him? Give the Holy Ghost to them that ask him. Everything you need to do, there is enough of the gift, of the grace, of the power of the Holy Ghost to accomplish it in your life. And as you ask, even tonight, more. More of him. More of Christ. More of heaven. More of the Holy Ghost. More of power it will grant unto you in Jesus' name. Number three now. Number three, the abiding sustenance for hungry supplicants. Abiding sustenance. When you have strength and then you go back home, that strength abides. You go to the place of work, that strength abides. You face any challenge and that strength is abiding. That's a glorious thing. But you know, somebody eats and then turns to the wife and says, my wife, even though we just finished eating now, I'm as hungry as if I've never eaten. As tired as if I've never eaten. I am as weary and worn out as if I've not eaten. Something is wrong somewhere. But you know, when you have the bread of life, bread of heaven, feed me until I want no more, and feed me forevermore, and then you are strong. And then you think you can climb any mountain now, and you can go on any journey now, and you can evangelize with what you have now, the wisdom, the revelation, and the power, and the ability. You can do whatever it is that the Lord is calling you to do. That's feeding. That's the kind of sustenance we are going to have in this workers' retreat in Jesus' name. You've got it, and then power will be settled in your life in Jesus' name. Look at Exodus chapter 16, and we're reading from verse 35. Exodus chapter 16, verse 35. And the children of Israel did eat manna 40 years. The children of Israel did eat manna 40 years, as they ate yesterday, and then they expended, they used the strength. Today, manna is there again. And they eat, and tomorrow, manna is there again. The manna that will sustain them for the journey of every day. The Lord has made provision for you. I said, the Lord has made provision for you. You will not lack. You will not be weak. You will not be weary. The manna you take from heaven will sustain your life until the end of the journey in Jesus' name. And the children of Israel did eat manna 40 years until they came to a land inhabited. Until they came to a land inhabited, they did eat manna until they came into the borders of the land of Canaan. Into the borders of the land of Canaan. Have you heard, you know, about some people? They say they are Christians and now they are getting older. Maybe they are 68 or 69. Maybe they are 72, 73 years of age. And then you don't see them in church, and you go to visit them, and it's not that they are sick, and they're just there at home. And then you say, brother, I look for you at the church today. I didn't find you. Oh, young man, you understand? We're getting older. And since we're getting older, we've stopped or we're stopping eating the manna every day. And so I've decided, I'll be selective now. I won't come to Sunday worship, Monday Bible study. Think about that. I've decided, you know, at this age now, I need to retire from eating. At this age now, I need to retire from praying. That's the time you need to pray more, because you are close to the border of the promised land that the Lord is taking you to. You need more sharp eyesight. You need more vision. And you need more revelation. And you need more strength at such a time like this. That's not the time to sit back and say, I cannot go there anymore. You will come to every service. You'll keep on coming until the Lord will get you to the border and lift you up in the mountain and say, see everything. See the mansion I prepared for you. And see your crown and see your reward. You will never stop in Jesus' name. I will not stop. Say it for yourself. I will not stop until you come to the borders of the promised land. You'll be on and on and on. Whatever your age, 72, 73, 83 or 89 or 90 or beyond, you'll be drinking the water of life continuously. And you will be eating this bread from heaven continuously. And as your days are, so shall your strains be. Okay, I'll say that for myself. As my days are, so will my strength be. The Lord confirm it in your life in Jesus' name. Hey, look at Psalm 68, verse 19. Psalm 68, verse 19. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation daily loads of benefits, loads of blessing, loads of solution, loads of revelation, and loads of power, loads of might every day in your life in Jesus' name. No day will you be weak, no day will you be fainting. No day will you be lacking, but every day, every day, every day in your life, in your life, in your life, He will daily load you with benefits in Jesus' name. Let's come to point number two now, is the divine purpose for angels' food before honest saints. The daily food that He gives us, and it is for saints who are honest. What does that mean? They are honest with themselves. I cannot live without His power. Without Him, I can do nothing. The prayers of yesterday are not enough. And the provision of yesterday is already used up in the journey of yesterday. If I'm going to move on as strong as ever, I need more of Him today. I need more of the bread today. I need more of the water today. I need more of His grace today. They are honest ways themselves, and when they hear of things happening to other people, so and so fell, so and so had a spiritual accident, so and so turned away from the way of righteousness, they're honest with themselves. Me too. Were it not for the grace of God, I'll be like that. Me too. If I don't eat the food daily, if I don't drink the water daily, I will be a person like that here. They are honest. And they are, as they are honest, they go back to the bread of life. And they have this divine purpose fulfilled in their lives. For angels' food before they are honest. Three things we're looking at. Number one, strength. Number two, support. Number three, surety. Number one, strength. For their purposeful journey. Strength for their purposeful journey. Number two, support for the pilgrim's joy. Number three, surety of perpetual justification. Look at number one, strength for their purposeful journey. Numbers chapter 10, verse 33. And they departed from the mount of the Lord 3 days journey. And the ark of the covenant of the Lord went before them in 3 days journey to search out a resting place for them. To search out a resting place for them. And then in searching out that resting place for them, they will need to walk there, travel there, make their journey there, and they will need bread from heaven so that they'll be strong for the journey to that resting place. Look at 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19, we're reading from verse 5. And as he lay, that's Elijah, as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. That's the prophet of power, the prophet of fire. He had become tired. Jezebel, the wife of Ahab, had sent a message to him and had said, by this time tomorrow, I'll take off your head from your body. Jezebel knew nothing. And there are people like that. They think they know, but they don't know anything. And they think they have the final say in the life of an Elijah. But they are mistaken. They think they have the final say in your life, and they are mistaken. No Ahab will have the final say in your life. No Jezebel will have the final say in your life. And even Elijah himself, Elijah, that great prophet of God, when he heard what Jezebel said, temporarily he forgot that Jezebel was not in the same class as he was. And sometimes, you know, you don't know which class you belong to. Maybe you're already a prophet, a professor, and you're up there, and there is somebody who has not even started primary one. That's Jezebel. He has not come into the school of the Almighty. He has not seen the Lord. He has not even learned the ABC, the alphabet of the righteous life. And then that illiterate spiritually threatens you, the professor up there. And then you forget your class. You forget where you normally ought to stand, and then you are running for that individual. And that's what happened to Elijah, and he was running. This is the man that prayed that there'll be no rain in the whole land. Jezebel was not in the same class with him. This is the one that prayed and said, why halt ye between two opinions? If God be God, serve him. If Baal, then serve him. And then he brought fire from heaven. Jezebel was not in that same class with Elijah. But Elijah forgot the class that he belonged to. And then he said, let me die. And God was not planning death for him. And God is not planning death for you. He was to go up in the rapture. The chariots of heaven, they were to come. And they were to come. Have you seen anyone flying an aeroplane and there's only one passenger? They don't do that. They wait until they have all those passengers to fill up the plane. But the chariot came from heaven for only one passenger. If you are the only one saved and sanctified waiting for the rapture, if you are the only one passenger, you will make the rapture. And so that chariot just separated between him and Elisha, and then he went up in a whirlwind unto heaven. But you know, before he got to that place, he needed to feed on angels' food. And before the rapture, and before that thing happens to you, and for you to recognize the class you belong to, you have to eat this food every time. As he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. Look at verse 6. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals, an angel cooked for him. I said, an angel cooked for him. He didn't know how precious he was in the sight of the Lord. He thought he was ordinary. He thought he was not worthy to live. And God sent an angel, and he cooked and he baked the cake for him, and a cruse of water at his side. And he did eat and drank, and lay him down again. Look at verse 7. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time. Until you are satisfied, the bread will keep coming. Until you are strengthened, the bread will keep coming. The angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. The journey, the Lord knows what's ahead of you. That's why I brought you to this workers' retreat. He knows if you don't have this food, you may not be able to walk all the journey through. And they were told in verse 8, and he arose, and he did eat and drink, and he went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. You'll eat the word of God. You take in the word of God. It will strengthen you for the journey ahead in Jesus' name. Number two, here, support for the pilgrim's joy. Support for the pilgrim's joy. You know, as we're going on in our journey, we need to be happy, glad, not sad, and joyful. And as we're going on, we need to be excited. I'm going on to the mount of God. And it is the word that brings that joy in your life. In Jeremiah chapter 15, reading from verse 16, Jeremiah chapter 15, verse 16. Thy words were found, and I did eat them. Thy words were found, and I sat down, and I had a good time to take in the word of God. I lifted it up from the page of the Bible. I put it into my system. And I allowed my spirit to meditate and to digest. And then it says, and thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. For I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. The joy of the word, the power of the word, the nutrition in the word will be yours in Jesus' name. That's why Job said in Job chapter 23, reading from verse 12, he said, neither have I gone back from the commandments of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. The Lord confirmed that in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. John chapter 15, verse 11. This is, have I spoken unto you? the word. This thing have I spoken unto you, that my joy may remain in you. The joy of the Lord will remain in you. And that joy of the Lord will be the strength of your life in Jesus' name. That your joy might be full. That your joy might be full. Whatever the level of joy is now, you are not saying, I even thank God. Even though it's like a trickle at the bottom of the glass, I thank God. How many people do I know that don't have any joy? How many people do I know that are sad all their lives through? Lord, I thank you. This little joy I have, I thank you. But Jesus said, don't be satisfied with that little joy. He says, I'm speaking my word unto you. You take in that word until your joy will be full. I missed your amen. Your joy over your own life will be full. You will look at your life, you will say, I am full. I am saturated. And the joy of the Lord, I'm so excited that it has filled my heart. It will happen to you. And then everything you expected of your wife, of your husband, and you said, if my husband could be like this, my wife could be like this, I'll be happy. He will do it for you. Everything you expect of your children, I want my children to be up and doing and to be spiritual, and I want them to be so excited about the things of the Lord and to have the understanding of scripture in their early age. I will be very happy if the Lord will do that. He will do it. Because that will fulfill your joy. And then you are saying, all the members of my house fellowship, all the members of my local church, if they could be like this, saved and sanctified and steadfast, I'll be so happy. My ministry is fulfilled. He will do it for you. Because he wants to so bless your life that your joy will remain and nothing will tamper with your joy. And that your joy will be full. Amen. 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 The Lord has done it. You'll be full of joy all around in your life in Jesus' name. Look at number three now. Number three, the surety of perpetual justification. Surety of perpetual justification. There'll be nothing to bring doubt in your life, fear in your life. You'll be so sure every time you belong to the Lord and the Lord belongs to you. Hebrews chapter 10. We're reading from verse 16, Hebrews chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 16. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their mind will I write them. The word is in the Bible. And then you read it, and sometimes when you're praying for a particular thing, you want to remember a particular promise that will carry you over, that will give you the assurance God has answered your prayer. Lo and behold, you cannot remember the promise. There are times you're looking for a particular spot and a particular thing in the word of God. You're saying you don't remember the exact quotation. How am I going to have that? If I could have that, I'll present it to God and say, God, look at what you have said. But I don't remember. The Lord said, he will solve that problem for you. He said, my laws I will put into their heart, and into their mind, in their mind will I write them, so that Anytime you need that word, it will come. You pray about it, and the word will be fulfilled in your life in Jesus' name. You know, tonight, if you can only ask, only seek, only knock, all these things we're talking about, God will gather them together and fulfill it in your life. You will never be the same again. And the kind of Christian you have been, and the kind of worker you have been, always tired. Early in the morning, always tired. Afternoon, always tired. Evening, always tired. Let's go and evangelize, always tired. Tiredness will vanish away. The joy of the Lord and the joy of the world will so be magnified in your life. You'll keep on running the race until the end in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number three now, and it is the divine power through angels put in harvesting soul seekers. Three things we're looking at. Number one, spiritual meat for born again sons and daughters. Sons and daughters. Do you know both sons and daughters can have the same provision from heaven, the same salvation from heaven, the same sanctification from heaven, the same Holy Ghost power from heaven, and the same strength from heaven? Sisters, you have everything the brothers can have too. The sisters are so few in the house. The Lord has heard your amen. He will fulfill it in Jesus' name. Number two, same meet with beloved sanctified disciples. Same meet. Have you noticed that in the land of Israel, all the members of the tribe, and Aaron and Moses, ate the same manna. Moses did not have any superior manna. Aaron did not have any superior manna. Caleb and Joshua did not have any higher grade of manna. Everyone ate the same manner. Let me tell you, I don't know whether this will shock you. Jesus Christ, when he came into this world, he emptied himself of divine power. He emptied himself of eternal sonship. And he made himself of no reputation. And he lived on the word of God. And when Satan came face to face to try him and to test him, he overcame not because he was the eternal Son of God, but on the basis of the word. And he told Satan, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that came out of the mouth of God. And when he read the scriptures, he found the place that was written of him. And he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I am anointed. He read that from the word. And then he came to his disciples after his resurrection. And he said, oh fools and slow of heart, to believe all the things that were written. And he opened their eyes that they might understand the scriptures. And he spoke to them the word written concerning him. All he had was the word, and he lived by the word, and he ministered by the word. And now, as Moses and Aaron, Caleb and Joshua, had the same manner as all the rest of the Israelites, and they became strong, eating the same manner, you too, with the Lord Jesus Christ, you too, as you are here on earth. Isn't that why he said, he that believeth on me, the same work I do shall he do. If he did all those things by divine eternal power of the Son, how will he tell you, ordinary human being, he that believeth on me, the works I do, he shall do. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to the Father. We have the same spiritual meat that Christ fed on. And when you eat at the same table, the same food, the same manner, the same word that kept him strong and kept him victorious, your victory will go on continually for the rest of your life in Jesus' name. Number three, strong meat for baptized servants in dominion. Servants of God, soul winners, soul seekers, you have dominion in Jesus' name. Look at number one here, spiritual meat for born again sons and daughters. Spiritual meat for everyone. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We're reading from verse 1. It says, moreover, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant how that all our fathers, every one of them were under the cloud. And they all passed through the sea. Look at verse 2. In verse 2, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Look at verse 3 here. And they did all eat the same. Moses, Aaron, Caleb, Joshua, all of them, all the Israelites, the men and the women, they did all eat the same spiritual meat. And then in verse 4, it says, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank out of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. That's what they had. That's what you have. We're going to be strong. You know, Moses, he was so strong. Till the end of his life, he remained strong, feeding on that same manner. And now the word of God is given to you in all fullness. Can I tell you that you'll be strong until the end of the journey? You'll be powerful until the end of the journey. The word is supposed to do in your life. Sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. You will do it by the word in Jesus' name. And then he says, by the cleansing of the water, by the word, he sanctifies them. He will do it in your life in Jesus' name. The power that comes through the word will come into your life. Witness God. Speak the word only, my servant shall be healed. I have no servant. Yes, you do. Your hand is your servant. Your feet, your servants. Your heart, your servants. Your eyes, your servant. Every part of your body, by the word, will be healed in Jesus' name. Look at number two here. Number two, the same meat with beloved, sanctified disciples, the same meat. Look at John chapter 4, verse 34. John chapter 4, verse 34, Jesus says unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Amen. Amen. The same thing, you can have that satisfaction and say, my meat, my strength, what keeps me going is to do the will of him that sent me. My brother, you'll do the will of God. My sister, you'll do the will of God. That will be your joy. That will be your meat. That will be the thing that gives you spiritual stamina and to finish his work. Everything he has given you to do, you will finish. Amen. Amen. Day after day, week after week, month after month, retreat after retreat, evangelism after evangelism, you will carry on until you finish. I want to see your face to tell you this, that you will finish well. And you will finish strong. Everything that will have hindered you, that you say, had I known, nothing will not be in your mouth. Because by the strength of the Lord, by the calling of the Lord, you will finish everything he has given you to do in Jesus' name. Number three is the strong need for baptized servants in dominion. You have dominion, you have power, you have authority, and the authority and the power, the dominion you have will not diminish. You go from strength to strength, you go from power to power. And when the time comes to see the Lord face to face, the Lord will stand up for you. That's how Jesus our Lord stood up for Stephen. And he said, behold, I see the heavens open, and the Son of God, the Son of Man, standing at the right hand side of God, waiting for him. Your case will be like that. And the Lord will welcome you home and say, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in all those things you did. Come on now and come into your reward. I see you there. By the eyes of faith, I see you there. And great will be your reward in Jesus' name. How does that happen? Acts chapter 1, we're reading from verse 8. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. And ye shall receive power. And ye shall receive power. You know, Peter was wondering, ye shall receive power. What power can I have? And I'll not deny the Lord anymore. What power can I have that I'll be able to tell those Pharisees and those Sadducees whether it is right in your sight or not to obey you rather than God? We want to declare unto you, we will obey God. And when they saw their boldness, they saw they had been with the Lord. When you come out of this retreat and people see you, the new power, the new ability, the new energy, and the new utterance, and the new dominion, and the new power, they will know you are coming from somewhere. You are coming from the Mount of Transfiguration. Because now, all that you need, everything, the Lord will supply. Ye shall receive power. Who is that? Where are you? I can't see you because you're sitting down. Are you going to receive power, anointing, ability? Ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost part of the earth. No door will be closed unto you. No mountain will be so high you cannot climb. And there is no power of evil, power of religion that will stand in your way. Jerusalem, you will do exploits there. In all Judea, you will do exploits there. In Samaria, you will do extraordinary there. To the uttermost part of the earth, you are now a conqueror. You are now a victor. Let the power come. Everything you have heard in the message today, let the power come. Ask, you will receive. Seek, you will find. Knock at the door. The door is open to you. Whatever you ask him, he will grant unto you now. Your life will come up higher, and the power of the Lord will be fulfilled in your life as you are fed for strength on the heavenly bread. Why don't you open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer?